Morning, everybody. Hope you're well. It's about 8:15. It's very, very sunny. I've been trying to work out whether to shut the curtain or not, but I feel like having moaned about there being no sun all year, I can't then shut the curtain, can I, when it gets sunny? I never know how whether you guys watch all these videos or whether some of you skip to the music or some of you skip past the music, but something I wanted to talk about this morning, I will rattle through comments and stuff and play a song, but I'd love your opinion on this. I want to talk about spam, bots and trolls. It's something that's only happened in the last couple of weeks on Facebook, but I'm just aware that it's been affecting some people's enjoyment of the live videos, and I really don't want it to. So basically, about 2 or 3 weeks ago, we suddenly tuned in for the Facebook Live videos, and rather than being the normal sort of 70, 100 viewers on the live one, there were suddenly 300. There were then loads of sort of weird comments like, "Dear sir, I have a business proposal for you," and one was, "This doctor has just brought my mother back to life," and all sorts. I think some of you are having some fun with them and sort of responding and stuff. And then just loads and loads of likes on the videos by just sort of suspicious looking accounts, and sort of 150,000 views on the video, and just weird stuff. I'd love to think that I was suddenly enormous in some territory around the world. That would be amazing. I'd love to think that I had fans all over the world, but unfortunately, being a bit more realistic, I think it's probably bots. Some kind of automated account. I've had emails from people saying I commented on a Facebook Live video and then I saw another comment under me which was using my profile and my name, but I didn't send that comment saying things that I wouldn't have said. And so I think some people have been worried about Facebook and identity and sort of just security in general. So that's that. And then on Saturday, we had, I guess, a troll. Someone with a fake name, sort of a weird sort of 80s headshot profile photo, just being really, really abusive, especially towards Sarah. And I didn't see the comments because I was trying to keep the show on the road and I saw where they were going, but I didn't, like I saw, but that was before it kind of got abusive. People then started trying to sort of tell that account to sort of to shove it and to ease off, and it's not in the spirit of the videos and everything, and that's totally true. But obviously this account, this person, this whatever, doesn't really operate like that. I don't know whether it was a real person, but it did seem to be reacting to things I was saying in the video, so it probably was. I got lots of really kind messages from a lot of you saying, you know, we hope you're okay, we hope you guys didn't see too many of the messages. And then somebody said, I think it was Paul, sent me a message and said that I've actually looked at their account and they've got like 3 friends. So I said, okay, well, it's probably just like a spam account. But it shook quite a lot of people. It shook, you know, my parents, my in-laws, a lot of you guys who were sort of worried about Sarah and that kind of thing. I banned the account before looking at the comments because I was just annoyed that it had sort of disrupted the show, because I thought the actual live video was really good. I really liked doing the REM and the New Radicals despite the Wi-Fi issues. And then I just couldn't shake it later in the morning, and so I was actually driving, so I pulled over and I looked at another spam account that I'd banned after the stream had finished, and I unbanned them and I realised that their comments became viewable again. So I went looking for this this account, this the one that was really abusive rather than just spammy, and it wasn't there. So I actually think that the account has now been deleted. I think enough of you probably reported it. I don't think it was a real person, but it seems to be a thing that only seems to be happening on Facebook. So I guess my question is to you, is it ruining your experience of it or not really? Facebook's good for me because most of my audience is on Facebook. You know, I've got about 5,000 people on Facebook and then about 2,000 people on Instagram and 2,000 people on Twitter. And like 1,000 on YouTube. So Facebook's the best one for me. And it's also really good that you can guys can share the streams and help, you know, show it to your friends and stuff. So Facebook is good, but it's getting increasingly spammy and I feel like I can't get through. I don't want it to get in the way of the real people that, you know, this has been such a lovely community and you guys have helped us so much through this time. We'd love to keep doing these videos, but we don't want it to be annoying and disruptive. And also, we don't necessarily want to move to a little smaller part of the internet. Like we could do it on YouTube. The video streaming and the audio quality on YouTube is much, much better, but then you've got less of that sharing aspect. And it's always nice to kind of, you know, widen the pool of people that we are exposed to. So, I don't know, what do you think? Do we move? Instagram is annoying because it means you all have to start new accounts. And it's vertical video, which is also annoying. Twitter isn't an option. I guess the only option is YouTube. And you could still post the YouTube link on your Facebook page, so we could still do it that way. And we can still have live comments and stuff, but then I think you need a YouTube account. I don't know. What do you guys think? I'm imagining that the general response will be like, no, it's fine. Let's just sort of agree not to rise to it and just to ignore those comments. I think that is the way to do it. But yeah, I don't want it to sort of slightly muddy or lessen the enjoyment of it, because Sarah and I put so much work into them and we so love doing them. I don't want it to become like a shouting match between us and some, you know, internet server or algorithm. But anyway, cheers. Second mug, I've got my Adelphi mug that I think Nick Dunk gave to us. I'd love to know your thoughts though. I mean, it is inevitably gonna probably slightly sully the experience, but I'm hoping that when you see those kind of comments on the you know, come up, because the comments are so much fun. It's the whole reason why the live videos are so much fun. I hope that when you see them coming up, you can just sort of ignore them, and you guys can still enjoy the music and enjoy the terrible quizzes and all that kind of thing. The last episode that I popped up was on Sunday. It was the episode that I've actually filmed on Friday that just didn't upload. The internet was terrible then, and it continued to be terrible the next day when we did the live video and it cut out. I played through Oh Boy, and I talked about meeting the girl at the side of the road and Sarah and I spending the day with her, and how it fed into the writing of the song. Mark says, I talked about Phoebe Bridgers and Bob Dylan albums. The Bob Dylan album is so, so, so good. And the Phoebe Bridgers album is also good, but I held the first one in such esteem that I'm slow to it, but I'm getting there. Mark says, Tom, my man, Phoebe Bridgers, Stranger in the Alps is an awesome album. I raved about it and failed to find anyone who agreed. Seeing her live at Scala was also one of those very odd gigs. It was sold out and everyone, bar my friend, was so unbelievably reverential, it was hard to enjoy it. I can't imagine you being reverential, Mark. I just wanted everyone to loosen up and enjoy it. I just imagine you going around the crowd and pushing everyone. Come on, enjoy it, enjoy it. I immediately left all her fan pages. She's still brilliant. Her fans seem drawn from those intense emo 20-year-olds who desire a messiah. Her new one is on the list of about 20 records I need. Yeah, but Mark, I kind of feel like her music does command that reference. I wish I'd seen her. I wish I'd seen the Better Oblivion shows as well, because I love that album. Gillian or Gillian says, hi Tom, it's funny to see that you played a song from the new guitar album. I've just got it for my husband's birthday and we keep playing it. Love all the songs. Thank you. Judy says, morning Tom, just seen the Lost Friday video. What a wonderful thing you and Sarah did to take the time and trouble and care to help that young girl. Not sure if many people would have helped, which is such a sad sign of society now. Thankfully, there are still good and kind souls out there like yourselves who do, and I'm sure what you did made an impact on her and gave some hope and light. Thank you for the story and song. Take care. Thanks, Julie. Debbie says, hi, Tom. As good people helping this child in crisis has, however, led you without closure. However, the time you spent with them that day is something they can reflect on just as you do. I know that you were a positive influence there when they needed one. Debbie, I hope so. I hope so. But in a way, I hope she's kind of forgotten the whole incident and that her life is just so blindingly brilliant now that she doesn't think about it. That would be great. All the merch has been arriving, all the t-shirts and the mugs. I love all these photos. Thank you so much. Ours are arriving today. So I'm hoping to be fully kitted out tomorrow evening for Wednesday Whisky. By the way, don't forget, 9 p.m. Wednesday Whisky. Facebook. Or will it be? No, it will be Facebook. For how long? I don't know. Lots of pictures of t-shirts. Chris says, oh boy, great insight, Tom. We can see that you really care and that makes you a great teacher. Thanks, Chris. And then Gary says, that song isn't depressing. A window on the world which shows hope as well. I feel as though there is a struggle, but that will continue. It was raining on Friday, so Gary says, never knock the so-called bad weather. Without the rain, there wouldn't be flowers. Gary, you romantic. Right, let's drink some coffee and play an Elliott Smith song. It's sunny. I should save all the Elliott Smith songs for the rainy days. It's such a beautiful day today. I need to go swimming. First swim of the year. Right, it's never good doing finger-picking songs in the morning because my hands are all sleepy. But let's try this. I can't really play it properly, but this is from Either Or, my first Elliott Smith album. And it's so beautiful. It's called Angelese. Someone's always coming around here, trailing some new kill. Says I've seen your picture on $100 bill. What's a game of chance to you, to him is one of real skill. So glad to meet you, Angelus. Picking up the ticket shows there's money to be made. Go on and lose the gamble, that's the history of the trade. As you add up all the cards left to play, to zero, sign up with evil Angelus. Don't stop me trying. Cause I'm all over it, Angelus. I could make you satisfied in everything. Secret wishes could right now be coming true and be forever with my poison arms around you. No one's gonna fool around with us. No one's gonna. So when I was at school, when I was about 15, I had a friend called Nick who gave me 3 albums. I always get given albums in groups of three, but I was given 3 albums. I was given Ryan Adams' Gold, which I just adored. Elliott Smith, Either Or, which I also adored, but it was the least forthcoming of the 3 albums. And then Naked Baby Photos, which is the greatest hits by Ben Folds. And I guess the Ben Folds leapt at me first and then kind of dissipated a little bit. And then the Ryan Adams was just great. And then the Elliott Smith eventually sort of came forth. And then I went to, I was meant to be doing a French exchange. And all my friends went in the summer holidays. And for some reason, I didn't go in the summer holidays. I think we were going on a family holiday. So I ended up going in the following Easter holidays. I can't have been the Easter holidays. I feel like it was the first, the sort of the Easter term, half term to Bordeaux, and I was completely on my own. No friends from school who were there. So every morning after I'd finished the language classes, I'd just sort of be wandering the streets of Bordeaux with my Discman, being an emo, and desperately trying to smoke the cigarettes that I'd managed to buy from the corner shop, trying not to cough, trying to be cool. But anyway, I found a Virgin Megastore in Bordeaux, and there was a bargain bin there, and I found the 2 more Elliott Smith records, Roman Candle and then the self-titled second album. I didn't really know anything about the order of the albums, but they were great, and even sort of darker and murkier. I then realised that after Either Or, that's when kind of the Good Will Hunting soundtrack happened, and then obviously he had more of a budget and he managed to make the more realised versions of the music he'd been hearing in his head all along, more influenced by the Beach Boys and the Beatles and EXO and Figure Eight, and eventually Basement on the Hill. But what was really sad is when I came back from that, maybe it was the Easter holidays, that French exchange, because when I came back, for my next birthday, I basically asked for all the Elliott Smith albums, and he died on my birthday. If somebody can tell me what year he died, then I'll be able to work out exactly how old I was. But I'm saying 2002. Could have been 2003. But yeah, 21st of October is my birthday, so. And that was the day he died. Yeah, I don't find Elliott Smith's songs sad. I find it difficult to find songs that beautiful sad. There's definitely a melancholy in them, and I think some people find them sort of unbearable to listen to, but I don't find them sad. I find them quite comforting, but I guess people treat music of different moods in different ways, don't they? I find some sad music incredibly comforting when I'm feeling sad. I feel like it's sort of a kinship. You get to sort of wrap yourself in the blanket of it and sort of submerge yourself, and sometimes wallowing is what you need. And other times, you just want to put on a Jamiroquai record and boogie your way out of the fug. But anyway, a bit early for that one with Sleepy Fingers, but got through it. Let me know what you think about the spam/bot/troll situation. I imagine we probably just crack on, right? It's a bit of a drag, but I don't want it to take away from sort of the real sense of community that we have on Facebook there, despite it being Facebook. But it should be said, though, that, you know, one day Facebook will disappear, and if you don't want to disappear from my reach, doing things like joining the mailing list, which is on the website, or if you've ever bought something from the online store or downloaded something from Bandcamp, you'll be on the mailing list. But that's the way to kind of keep in touch with me. Or joining on another social media platform like Instagram or Twitter. That's also an option. Folks, have a lovely day. We've got 2 new covers ready for you tomorrow evening, Wednesday, 9 p.m. Hopefully we'll be fully kitted out in our t-shirts and mugs, drinking whiskey from our mugs. And yeah, be nice to see you there. And don't feed the trolls. Remember, don't feed them.